si me amarás mañana.
And hello, and welcome. I am so honored to be with all of you today. My name is Mike Blinder, and as I look at these computerized things on my screen and see that people are still joining us, we'll pause for a second. There's my ugly face coming to you live from Tampa Bay, Florida. Welcome to a platform called Zoom, and I bet just about everybody on this call wishes they bought stock in it a while ago, am I right? It's become the fad, and it's not the first and only webinar platform. And the reason I bring that up to you is some of you are already doing commerce on Zoom or using it or playing games with your friends or whatever, but you have joined Zoom likely through a meeting platform. This is Zoom webinar, a little bit more advanced. And what it means is I'm totally in control. You can't all just jump in and start talking like you normally do on Zoom, because this would turn this whole meeting into a kegger. We only have an hour together. There's now many of you still joining us, but I'm going to let one lady, if I may, join us because she's paying my freight today. Sue, are you with me today? Hello.
I am. Thank you. And hi. Welcome.
Go ahead.
I would just like to welcome everyone to the seminar who's on and is signing in. And just note that it's our goal that they take away some ideas that will spark their creativity and help them with promoting their business during this very unusual time. And Mike, I'd also like to take a minute just to thank the Daniel Island Town Association and Jane Baker and the Daniel Island Business Association and Chuck Latif for not hesitating to co-sponsor the seminar when I brought the idea to them. They jumped right on. So thank you, Chuck and Jane. And I also want to say many of the people on this seminar are not just customers or business connections, but they're friends. And we're so very thankful for what they provide to our community. And our goal through your presentation is to not help them just survive, but to thrive.
Wow, I love the way you put words together. I bet you're a publisher of a newspaper. That's amazing. I thank you for such hashtag blushing, Sue. Now, one of the things Sue's going to do is because I am going to be racing through some content in the next hour. This is my fifth broadcast this week, and I've got one in an hour and a half that's going to be going to an international audience. So I'm working out of a studio here in Tampa Bay, Florida, is that Sue's going to watch the chat, the questions. Go to chat at the bottom of the screen. Feel free to comment to yourself, comment to others, comment to me questions and concerns you have. Sue will kind of monitor them. She may answer some locally to you. Save the best for last, obviously, and the important ones, because if I keep my eyes on that, I won't be able to keep my eyes on the slide. So Sue, we'll bring you back a little later. Is that okay?
Yes, thank you.
All right, so let's get to work. Who am I? Many of you have Googled me. If you haven't, I publish a magazine called Editor and Publisher. It's been around 1884 was the first edition. I picked it up in September. It's the Bible of the news publishing industry. Its roots are in newspapers. And I'm honored to be part of this iconic brand. Prior to that, this is where Sue and I got to know each other over the years. I was a pretty well-traveled media consultant. I worked with over 350 newspapers around the world. I've been to India 6-8 times, all over Europe, Asia. I just got back from a trip to Honduras, and I've been a consultant helping newspapers through the years adapt into digital things, because I was a nerd and a geek, if anyone knew what the internet was. And I wrote a book called Survival Selling. It is, oh, here's your first acronym of the day. It is a B2B, business-to-business sales guide. I wrote in 2009, we'll get to the reason why I wrote it in a moment, because this is called the Survival Marketing Workshop, wrote in 2009 when everybody was running for cover during a very tough economic time. I call it my million seller because I have a million copies in my cellar, but you get a free copy at the end of the workshop if you fill out a form. It'll be a digital copy, but I'll give you instructions on how you can meld it into any e-reader you have or whatever, tablet, Kindle, or whatever. I'm also an old guy. You can wish me a happy birthday if you like, because tomorrow I will turn 63. And the only reason I'm revealing my age to you is this is not my first economic downturn. This is my fourth in my adult life, my third professionally. And I by no means saw this coming. I am watching the news just as stunned as you. I still cannot figure out where we're going and what we're going to do through this crisis. And I'm analyzing it and digesting it as much as you are, but I'd rather put those issues aside right now, the medical ones, the hurtful ones, the ones we're all dealing with, especially as we worry about our fellow men and our loved ones, and I'm always praying. And I want to just discuss for the rest of our journey together the economics of all this. And if there's one thing I've known in my 30-some-odd years in media, 20-some-odd years as a senior media consultant in the news publishing industry, is a famous quote from a hero of mine. This is Bruce Barton. You may have heard this quote because it's been tossed around and modified over the years. By the way, Mr. Barton was an ad executive in the Great Depression of the 20s. He went on to run for Congress in New York State as a Republican and served for 4 years. But he had a famous expression, which was, in good times, people want to advertise. In bad times, they have to. And that is kind of teeing off our dialogue today. And I can't stress this enough, but you don't have to advertise the same way you did. You should reinvent yourself. There is opportunity in tough economic times. I know that sounds odd, but it's almost the time where the strong can get stronger. And that has been proven. By the way, if I can go back in time to that Great Depression of the late 20s, early 30s, Chrysler reinvented itself. When car sales were plummeting, its market share increased massively by reinventing, retooling a factory and coming up with a brand new automobile that was much more cost effective. In the 70s, a famous grocery chain up in Chicago took advantage of this phenomenon that occurred in the 70s. You young people on this call may not know this, but credit cards were really not entered into our society until the late 60s. It was an absurd thing to think of actually charging things. And in the 70s, Bank of America Card and Master Charge, they both adapted their names since then, became more relevant in our society. But this grocery store owner said, wait a second, I get this. If times are a little tough, let's let people buy things on time. And boy, did it surge. But let's go to 2008. Because this is when my business was so embedded in the news publishing industry. I had clients all over the world. This recession was not caused anywhere close to what we're going through now. But it was similar in the fact that it came out of nowhere, if you think about it. There was no warnings on this one, like the one we're going into now. A month before the recession of 2008, you might remember the markets were surging. Very few people saw this massive downturn that came instantly. And at that time, I was working all over the world. And during that time, we actually helped 25,000 small businesses like you and I. Actually, let's use our next acronym, SMB, small, medium-sized business. That's what I am, and that's what you are. Grow, prosper. And a lot of studies have been done since that recession. Because now we can look back on the last 12 years. Even McGraw-Hill did a study that showed that those that marketed during that recessionary period are doing better than those that didn't, especially on the back end. See, if there's one thing I know, and I don't know what's going to be different at the end of this period, I do know there is going to be an end. I can't tell you when. I'm not a prognosticator. I have no crystal ball. I buy high and sell low on the market. But I know we're going to get out of this. And when you do, you got to look at yourself then and prepare for it. Coopers and Libren did a study that we were kind of part of that basically took a more aggressive tactic. It basically circled back to the concept of market share. Whether you're B2B like me, business to business, or B2C, business to consumer, or product or service driven, there's only a finite number of customers you have. And now that the markets are contracting, that's even more finite. And you're really battling others for that critical piece of the pie. That's what market share is all about. Even Harvard did a study on it and basically said, if you market through tough economic times, you come out of it stronger. Now, I'm not implying you're at war, although I have dusted off my copy of Sun Tzu's Art of War. It was actually written on parchment 2,000 some years ago by a Chinese warrior and how to win battles. And by no means I'm saying you shouldn't love your neighbor right now, because you may be battling for market share with a local business right now in Daniel Island. I don't know. There's so many different stripes and flavors of businesses on our broadcast today, but your real battle may be with the internet. good or bad, right or wrong, this is a digital society. Look at us on Zoom right now. Who knew we'd get to this, that people would start getting comfortable in a virtual exchange? I'm lucky that I built this studio 6 years ago so I could work out of my house, because I do so much digital training with the green walls and all that stuff. So I'm sitting here, believe it or not, guys, I'm in Tampa Bay right now wearing shorts. I just throw this jacket on, got another one coming up in a couple hours. But digital could be disrupting you beyond your comprehension. You obviously know in retail today that e-commerce is starting to just become the, not only growing, but the thing. And if you're a retail business, you are competing with the internet now. Now, things happen during tough economic times as well. It's not only an economic downturn. Societies shift and change. We'll get to that about 2008. But right now, certain age groups that never thought that they would go to Amazon or other websites to buy things. I never predicted people would buy furniture on the internet. I mean, that was unheard of, you know, 10 years ago. My wife likes to shop. When I was a kid, social media was, wait for it, the mall. I come from a social baby boomer society that likes to go to stores and pull things off the shelves. That's why so much money is invested in the packaging of the products today. But we're in a wacky world now. And it's going to stay that way likely on the back end. Are you truly marketing through this so you can survive on the back end? But it goes beyond just basic retail now. The financial advisors on this broadcast are under siege by robots. I mean, you might think when you're asking questions on a website, an investment website, you're getting a live person. You're not. You're getting what's called a bot. Geico and Progressive are all digital, right? Go online, go online. And they're lying in a slight way because they imply your local insurance agent is more expensive. I promise you, if you sit down with your local insurance agent, they'll match any deal. They will, but they'll be there to hold your hand through the process. My guy showed up 6 months ago in my driveway, took a picture of my fender bender for me. Said, don't worry about the app, I'll take care of you. And there's no such thing as a cheaper mortgage. We have a few realtors on this with this study. I love that industry, and they are surviving very nicely when people predicted 10, 15 years ago that the entire industry would go under thanks to the digital revolution, because realtors perform a very valuable part of a very critical thing, which is moving. Relocating is one of the top five stressors in human life. But there's no such thing as a cheaper mortgage. You financial guys on this know that as well. So that's kind of a lie. Do you really want to buy your car on the internet? Do you want to have a doctor on FaceTime prescribing things for you? And I definitely want to deal with my local realtor, whether I'm on the buyer side or the seller side, no ifs, ands, or buts. So as I talk about changes in society, and I don't know, see right now the pundits are trying to figure out what your customer will look like on the back end of this. And we're in the middle of it, so we really don't know. But everything's changing. Will the restaurant of tomorrow be the same as the restaurant we just left? Will we congregate like we used to? My biggest expenditures for the last few years were conferences. That's how I interacted mostly with my customers, for my magazine especially, because I'd go to all over the world to all these news media conferences. They're gone. What a world, what a change. But let's go back to 2008, because what happened in 2008, now we can analyze it, we've studied it, is we had a society pre-recession that thought it was okay to go in debt. It was fine to buy a house you really couldn't afford, wink, wink. You don't have to put the 20% down, max out your credit card. Who cares about your credit rating, right? Now, post 2008 recession, it became hip to save money. If you drove a big expensive gas guzzler, or still do today, some give you a look like, who are you? Don't you get it? It's not about impressing anyone anymore. It's about being fiscally responsible. And the cheapest people on the planet right now are the millennials. We trained my children. I'm a baby boomer, so my children are the millennials. We trained them that frugality is cool. Millennials do not buy expensive houses. Ask any realtor. They want good housing. We call them millennial villages here in Tampa. They're springing up everywhere at a mid-level price point. Millennials buy used cars, not new cars. Used inventory is on fire, and they're minimalists. And the other thing about millennials, and we're all shifting as well, is there's no semblance of brand loyalty post-recession of 2008. Loyalty went out the door. It's value. Pre-recession of 2008, you had a favorite restaurant chain. You had a favorite fast food company. Now it's dollar menus and value meals, CVS and Walgreens down here in Florida. I'm sure you know, we're not too far from you down here. You're just one state up, not two, excuse me. But down here, I say every street corner is the corner of CVS and Walgreens. And all they do is try to bring you in with milk and eggs, right? Toilet paper pop, the eggs and milk are in the back of the store. That's a loss leader, by the way. Ernst & Young says that 1 out of 4 American adults are loyal to a product or service. So why did I spend the last 15 minutes doing this diatribe on the shifting and the necessity, and you got to market? This is an advertisement, not for the Daniel Island News. I love Sue. I'm honored that she brought me to you this way. But this is not commercial for the Daniel Island News. I would love you to market with Sue. I'd love you to do it with her competitor. Don't get mad at me, Sue. I don't care if you beat a drum, hire a skywriter, dress someone up like the Statue of Liberty, shove a darn arrow in their hand and put them in front of your business. But you need to advertise. This is a commercial for advertising in some way, shape, form, or size. Now, if I've established that in our first 15 minutes, and hopefully you've bought into it, let's then discuss the next step. How do you do it? Now, that's not changed. I'm sometimes accused when I do speeches at big nerdy conferences where all the digital experts show up, and I was a nerd before anyone knew what it was, that I always circle back to basics, and you may disagree. But I always think that as things advance, sometimes it's better to go back to the basics. See, the basic formula for any success in marketing to get the best return on your investment, there's another acronym, is reach and frequency. That has never changed. I've been preaching this for over 30 years. When I started off as a disc jockey and eventually got into sales and radio and managed radio and TV stations, if you Google me, you'll see that was my background. I always stress this to any small business, that if you want success from your media expenditure, it's just two words. I mean, after all, when you purchase media of any type, you're simply renting eyeballs, aren't you? I mean, that's it. You got to rent the right ones. Okay, it's now 1603 and I'm trying to sell a cow. So I have to do some advanced marketing, right? Because I got a cow, it's my inventory, and I want to sell it. So I got to nail a note to a tree. That's advanced marketing in 1603. Well, aren't I going to research first the paths the cow buyers are on and stick my note on that specific path, because paper's expensive and I refuse to waste it. Today they call that niche marketing and target marketing and particle marketing. Just the same. Media changes. We just change the notes in the trees. You got to target your customer and stop doing what I call SOS. There's another acronym. I call it shiny object syndrome purchasing. You small business owners like to test media. We see that in a lot of studies. You'll purchase a specific type of media to test it because it's new, even though it's not targeting your customer. I call that spaghetti marketing because you're throwing something against the wall and see what sticks. Rule number one is you don't waste one penny of your media expenditure. You target your customer. That's reach. Now, who is your customer? That's up to you to tell us in media. That's why we do a needs analysis. That's why we do a discovery. Some call it the ascertainment. It means we learn from you who your customer is. Sometimes in media, we try to get you to think out of the box because you may not know that you've saturated a certain region or what we call demographic, an age group or an income. Here, it's simple. Your customer has four dimensions, and they are young, old, rich, poor, near, far, man, woman. I know it sounds basic, but it's that simple. But you may have saturated a certain place. You may not know this, but people will drive pretty darn far for a deal offer or special. So niche is what's in now. And what really has changed over the years is the death of not newspapers, but mass media. You see, the newspapers of yesteryear were mass media. 80% of 18 plus adults touched a newspaper every week. That doesn't exist anymore. The average reach of newspapers in North America today, the printed newspaper product, not the digital, not the online, which goes well beyond that, is less than 50% of 18 plus adults. That may not surprise you, or it may, but in places like Daniel Island, it's much higher when you don't have competition for the hyper-local news on your island. In the big cities, those printed newspapers have much less reach because you have multiple TV stations. You may even have a blogger, someone online that's doing a better job covering the football team than the newspaper is today. So there's much more competition for local news. But when we call the community markets, much higher reach. Now, newspapers were the 80% reach mass media. So was this guy. I'm 63 on tomorrow. So I remember as a kid, a program on television called The Ed Sullivan Show. None of you, I would say half of you don't even know where I'm going with this. This was a guy that owned Sunday nights for about 20 years on CBS. 8 o'clock Sunday nights, 80% of North Americans watch this show and no one could program against it. You see, it was mass media because it was something that doesn't exist anymore. Ed Sullivan was a variety show. In the same 60 minutes, you could see an opera singer followed by a puppet for your kids, followed by a stoned out rock and roll band for your teenagers. That does not exist. You see, newspapers are one of the best niche products. If you're looking at a newspaper, odds are you make more money, you're educated, you lean towards being a little bit older like me, and you own a home. And local news consumption tends to be a bit older. What I mean by that, what I mean by that is you don't care about local news until you become an adult. People think, well, newspaper. No, I mean, you just don't care about school boards and local politics until you get a bit older and get more invested in your community. But in order to achieve a younger audience, we go digital as well. The Daniel Island News has an amazing print product. I was leafing through them for the last, you know, few weeks. And I'm just looking at the great job we do at hyper-local reporting. But then you get the same products digitally as well. What I also like about the island is the massive social media footprint. You see, people don't just get their news the old ways anymore. Don't think people just go to a website anymore. You got to push it to them. Many of you enjoy your news in your Facebook news feed. That's why the Daniel Island News has, what, 50? They have more likes. That's when you go to a business page and say you like it than my magazine does. Very, very exciting to see these kinds of growth for local news consumption. In other words, a newspaper is not a newspaper anymore. It's a media company. So anyway, let's circle back to the traditional media and look at it now. I mean, I don't know if there's any billboards where you are. Down here, they're everywhere in Florida. But this is a media that in my state, in my town, realtors just cling to. They go nuts on every other billboard in Florida is a realtor or a lawyer. Now, that's fine. But I don't like that form of marketing for this reason. It is local. There's no question that a billboard is stuck in a neighborhood for a reason. It has a geography, all right? But who's driving by it? Young, old, rich, poor, near, far, man, woman. I know the realtor is desperate for that listing. If you're in the real estate industry, I get it. I understand there's two halves of the equation, the buy side and the sell side. But the listing is more than just getting half that equation. A listing is a great marketing tool. Once you have a listing, you can stick a sign in front of a house in a neighborhood to show your activity. You can host an open house. Listings are essential to the real estate equation of growth. So you put a billboard in a neighborhood in hopes to tell the homeowner to list with me. Really? I mean, that's pretty much the reason. But the problem is the guy driving by could be the kid, could be grandpa who's already downsized, could be the guy coming to mow my grass. It's not targeted, either as any other form of outdoor advertising. This is growing in Florida. I don't know if you have it in Daniel Island or wherever you guys shop, but you could spend thousands of dollars sticking your face on a shopping cart. I get that shopping centers and grocery stores are local, but you're a baby sitting on it, not to mention, and who's pushing the cart. Now, many use direct mail for reach, for targeting, and I'm not against direct mail's targeting. In the old days, you would buy direct mail by zip code. Now you can actually buy pretty highly targeted lists. Young, old, rich, poor, near, far, man, woman. Those are the four dimensions. Young, old, rich, poor, near, far, man, woman. The problem with direct mail goes to the two important factors I said earlier to guarantee ROI with any marketing investment. It's reach and frequency. I mean, you hate commercials. I hate everybody, especially in the broadcast world, hates commercials. So you tend to avoid them. We started with tapes in our cars. Some of you are so young, you don't even know where I'm going with this. We had cassettes and 8-tracks. Then we moved to satellite, which is going away. Very few people now pay for satellite. They stick their phone into a sync function in their car. All new cars now, actually, Tesla has taken AM and FM radios out. GM and Chrysler are saying they're going to, because you're syncing. Your phone is how you get your news. Your phone is how you get your music. You might be able to have a favorite podcast. You'd abhor commercials on television. In the old days, when I was young, we used to have tape machines in our home that never worked. Then we graduated to these boxes people call DVRs. Except today, you know what you're doing. You're not using that box anymore. You're binging. And anybody under 30 has cut the cord. So listen, here's the challenge. If you hate commercials, we in media know that, so we keep putting them in front of you. We clutter your world with ads now, because you're avoiding them in the traditional media, so we stick them everywhere. The average human being in North America is now impacted by 5,000 messages a day, because everywhere you look, there's an ad on your clothing, on your cars, on the receipts we give you. We're sticking them everywhere. Flat screen TVs are so cheap. Wherever you go, you see them. You pump gas and you're watching a TV commercial. McDonald's is selling McTV. This is the shopping cart coming to your grocery store. Outdoor advertising is totally interactive, and I hope I don't offend you. This is a men's room in Hartford, Connecticut at the Hilton Hotel. How to take a picture. See, I like direct mail's targeting. What I don't like is its expense, because it costs money to do multiple hits. Direct mail tends to, for small businesses, be a one-hit wonder because it is so darn expensive. So now we've discussed the dimensions of reach and frequency, and I'm only halfway through our journey. And when I crafted this new product, I kept thinking, okay, let's get to the basics, but that's only half the equation, because you have a goal for being here today. You have some goal. It's not just learning how to advertise. There's a reason why you want to do it. And it might be something as basic as this. You are open for business and people don't know it. All right, so how does that fit into our equation? Well, remember, reach and frequency is simply the media that people consume. That's just renting the eyeballs and doing it often. Then you got to stick a message in there, right? And that message has got to do something for you. So let's do a case study now. Let me be a media consultant for a business. And the business I'm picking is not here in Tampa. It's near and dear to me because it's in my family. It's my brother-in-law in Nashville, Tennessee. Let me introduce you to Mike Hilsamer. He's the tall guy hugging one of his employees at the restaurant he's managed just about 30 years now in Nashville. It's called Rafferty's. We don't have any here in Tampa. I haven't seen them a lot in my travels, but it's definitely popular in Nashville. Mike's hugging an employee he let go. Yeah, he's shut down. I mean, he's got 5 people working now. He's the manager, he's got the chef and a few others working the store all day, hoping they can do delivery and marketing the best he can. Come and call me, I'll have that great meal ready and we'll carry it out to your car. So he told me on the phone a few weeks ago he's using his Facebook page. And I got a little nervous about that and said, Mike, there's 2 reasons why this may not work for you. Number one, you have a pretty low reach on your Facebook page. You only have 600. And by the way, not a lot of you on this call may know this, but your Facebook reach is much lower than you think it is, because many small business owners don't manage their Facebook page. They have someone else do it for them, like their kid or their receptionist or somebody named Daryl down the street, am I right? But if you manage your page and you log into it, so here I am logging into the E&B page, this magazine, which is B2B focused. I want Sue to go to this page and click my like button, where we have not as many as she's got. I'll tell you right now, we have about 4,000 likes. Sue's got over 5, but the mission for me is to get Sue to like it, not you, because Sue is a media executive. And when she's looking in her Facebook, they call it the news feed, friends from high school and church, family, college, and what have you, I'm hoping she wants to see industry news in there. The reason Sue's audience is so huge for newspaper is people want to see the local news in that same news feed. But what Sue knows and her editor knows is that even though she's posting content to that huge audience, the reach can be lower. See, Facebook brought your reach down, and it should be obvious why. They want you to click that little boost button and pay just to get your message out now. And that's how Facebook is making millions and millions and millions of dollars a day. But the second challenge I have with Facebook is not just the low reach. The second challenge I have is that most times you're just preaching to the choir. These are people who already know you. They're aware of you. Facebook doesn't really help you grow your business. Facebook is a great loyalty tool. You see, I've got to like you to like you. Let me say that again. I got to know you first before I put you in my newsfeed. So you're reminding me why I should love you through social media. So I stay with you and don't go to that competitor that's trying to steal your business. Now, what you got to do with social media is externalize it. That's what I said to Mike. What I did is I actually sent an email to my subscribers in Nashville. I have 52,000 loyal subscribers to my product. So I sliced and diced it to Nashville. Most people know I published the magazine. So I put out a personal email saying, my brother-in-law has a great restaurant. Why don't you check it out? Kind of worked. I got beyond his Facebook newsfeed. But if you really want to do things proper, you want to really put your messages on other Facebook pages that have more audience, that externalize your message. But let's go to a different externalization now for Mike. Again, this is our case study. I just happened to pick the restaurant because it's somebody I'm working with during COVID-19 as a media consultant. Now, remember, there's two types of consumers for your product or service, whether you're B2B or B2C. There's the passive one. That's what I was doing when I stuck that email out. I was just trying to jazz a human being that may not think about going out tonight, or in that case, just doing takeaway, right? I was trying to jazz someone to change their buying habits. That's what we do in newspapers when we place an ad next to editorial content. The person opened up the newspaper for the local news, and there's an ad to get their attention and excite them to do something. That's taking someone from passive to active. What if there's already an active person? This person is hungry right now. They're determined to do takeaway. They just can't figure out who to do it with. Or you're determined to order pizza or get a plumber because your sink is leaking. Or you got to find a doctor or dentist. Now, in the old days, you went to Yellow Pages for that. Yellow Pages was active media, not passive media. You don't go to Yellow Pages, pour yourself a beer and read it for fun. Am I right? You went there to seek something. Well, we all know where you go today. You go to Google and you type in things like who's delivering food now in Nashville. And this was the page I got yesterday on Google. The problem was Mike ain't there. Grubhub has an ad. So if someone goes to Google, Grubhub won that one. He ain't in the map because all the pizza places that only do delivery are there. Then Eater's got a, I never heard of Eater. And there's another, he's not even on the first page. So he's losing the battle since he only works with Uber Eats. See, he's not getting the... Your goal should not be having anyone having to seek you. Your goal should be having people know you. So hold that thought, because let's go to your goal now. When we asked 3,500 small business owners all over North America, what do you want from your advertising expenditure? The answer is pretty basic. I want a return on my investment instantly. I want to grow. I want a new customer. I call those the three C's, the call, click, or customer through the door. But what do your customers want if they want to try a new product or service? What does it take for you as the media, as the regular product or service consumer, what's it take for you to change your buying habits? Again, thousands of people will ask that question. What makes you try a new product or service? And guess what? It's a deal. It's an offer. It's a special. You got to bribe them. It all circles back to that frugality thing now of 2008. I mean, we are cheap, so you're going to have to bribe them. But how do you do a good bribe? How do you do a good offer? Well, first of all, no one believes percent off anymore, especially millennials. Research shows that millennials want what I call the dots connected. You say 10% off, they just don't, what is that? He raised his price 10%. Think about today's auto dealer. They have a really hard job. They want to get you off the couch to the lot to look at the inventory. So they do deals, right? And specials, but they don't say this car is 5% off. They've got it down to a science. When you see an auto dealer ad trying to make you be active from passive, they do a price point. $199 a month, no money down. That's simple. If you're a furniture store, couch was $349, now $149. That works. BOGO rocks with millennials. Buy one, get one. They get that in a heartbeat. But if you're doing a deal like this, if you're the car dealer and you're saying $199 a month, no money down, the last thing you're going to say after that sentence is, relax, take your time. The lot is full. We have so much inventory, we don't know what to do with it. No, if you want an instant return from your bribe and you want it to work, you got to make it time sensitive. You got to take the offer and you got to give it immediacy. People want what they can't have. Scarcity increases desire. It goes back to the concept of supply and demand. Do you remember Cabbage Patch Kids? Some of you don't even know what I'm talking about, but man, this was not even that great of a product, but because it was so scarce, everybody wanted them. But Apple has more money than most countries today. You know they could put 1 million phones in the marketplace on day one, but they don't for a reason. They don't because it creates scarcity. And I'm still flipping about this toilet paper shortage that's not real. Take it from a guy that has to print a magazine. Ask Sue, there's plenty of paper. There is no shortage of paper. There's too much of it, actually. It's just you're demanding it so much that the supply, and that's why the price went up. If we all took a breath and just went back to our normal shopping habits, there'd be plenty of toilet paper. My wife is scared now because of all the issues with the meat plants. She's going out to Costco today to load up on meat on our freezer. I mean, my wife is scared of scarcity. I don't know. Just supply and demand. So here's a bad ad. I like this message, especially during COVID-19, because you're being nice to a consumer who's worried about money. We're worried about health and loved ones. Let's put that aside. I can't dwell on that right now during this dialogue. We only have this short hour, and we could go on for a long time just discussing the horrors of what we're going through. Let's just discuss the economics. People right now are scared financially, but they still may need transportation. So this business is doing a great, we'll delay the payment, but where's the time sensitivity? This is what I like better. This guy's got it. I'm okay, I can delay payment, but you gotta act quick. I know the secret for any business to get through economic downturns, let's just put media aside. I'm just discussing one aspect of survival, which is your need to market and how to do it. But the secret to getting through this is just time and money. Am I right? Now I have the ability now, I've been marketing new products to my customer base, saying to them, I'm okay extending the payments for you. Thank God we can do it. I mean, we're pinching every penny here, but I'm doing that because I know that they'd rather have the income from the product first before they have to deal with the expense. I'm not demanding payment in advance. In the old days, you had to have your payment in before we ran the ad. If you can do it, you may have a more loyal customer in the long run. Now, I'm not advocating by any stretch of the imagination that you should do offers and deals. That is not the only messaging in media, and it can hurt you. I'm saying if you want instant return, that seems to be the best way. But deals and offers can destroy your business. It destroyed Jaguar. Their sales went down massively. Remember this couple of years ago? Was it 3 years ago? They started marketing a Jag for $349 a month, no money down. And Jag owners were offended. Talk about tarnishing a brand. Joseph A. Bank has cut way back on their sales because it got to a point where no one thought they had a real price. You remember all those commercials? They were all on top of each other. Buy one suit, get 12 free. Buy three ties, get four. Everybody couldn't figure, it just went nuts. And there was no integrity. And not all business sectors. Not all business sectors can do deals, offers, and specials. Realtors don't say, quick, list with me and get half off. Lawyers don't say, quick, have an accident now. And Service Master doesn't say, we hope you have a flood. See, what these businesses are doing is they're softening any idea of doing a deal. And they're working more towards, how should I put this? They're doing a branding message. And if you really want to do a great branding message in today's very tumultuous time, I would consider a give message, like buy one, give one. That's starting to really come through here in Tampa Bay. A lot of local businesses are saying, if you buy a buy five pizzas, and for every five you buy, we're giving one to the hospital. We have a home improvement place, the big door fixer. First of all, in all his ads now, he's saying, you don't even have to talk to us. We're totally COVID-19, you know, no human contact necessary. Just leave the, we'll come in and fix it for you. But he's also saying that we're giving 5% of all of our proceeds back to these funds. You might want to consider that kind of a branding message. Then people may make the decision to do business with you and become more akin to you, increases your brand. But branding does more than just make people like you more. It establishes one of the most important acronyms of our dialogue, which is TOMA. And people in media know this one because we've been discussing it as a concept in media for decades. It stands for Critical Top of Mind Awareness. You see, you don't want people going to Google. You don't. When you send them to Google, someone may to find you. Someone may get your customer that way. You want to plant the seed ongoing about your business in the mind of every current customer and potential customer within your reach. So if and when they need your product or service, you rise higher than the other guy. You rise top of mind. But in a competitive society, and especially now, when the markets are contracting and market share is even more critical, I want you to consider your USP in every message you do. And this is not a dyslexic turnaround for United States Postal Service. It stands for unique selling proposition. Those of you that have taken a marketing class know where I'm going with this. You must define to the consumer what makes you faster, cheaper, or better than the competitor at all times. And I said faster, cheaper, or better. It doesn't have to be all three. You don't have to be the cheapest guy to survive. And while you're doing that, I also want you to connect the dots. Many people use outdated unique selling propositions. They say things like, trust the name you know, been in business since 1968. The number one radio station, here's another acronym for you, and in your town is WIIFM. I know it's, some of you know where I'm going with this as well. It stands for what's in it for me. It means, it's actually a definition of what we call benefit selling. You don't name a feature like I've been in business since 1998, you define the benefit. Now, in the case of this ad, which we're going to correct, this was a billboard and a print ad for a small business in Sioux City, Iowa. We were consulting the newspaper and then the advertiser was on a call. We did the needs analysis, and you got to understand the flooring industry can be under siege, not just by the internet, but by what we call lead generation companies. Whenever you watch those commercials where they have the jingle playing with the 800 number, that's not a local flooring store. That's a lead generation company getting your lead, and then they're tell you a guy's gonna come to your living room with a book to sell you flooring. And they're selling that lead to someone that might be 100 miles away who may be willing to come to town and do three or four of those. And I'm not saying the guy doesn't do a good job, but what this business is trying to say is, I'll be here to service you when the other guy isn't. So say it, connect the dots. Get the right words in your branding message. Now, I'm going to give you two secrets before we end our journey. We only have 15 minutes left. To help you brand yourself properly, not just in tough economic times, but in all times. The first one's a no-brainer because it comes through the Great Recession of 2008. When 2008 and 9 hit us, we didn't just become cheap as a society, we became wary. What I mean by wary is you didn't want to spend your hard-earned money till you saw what someone else said about the business. That's why Angie's List started through that time. And then you started seeing reviews on special websites like Yelp. And then eventually your social media channels opened up with reviews. And then Google took it on and everybody's now dissing or endorsing you. Am I right? And in different business sectors, it's happening all the time. The challenge with that is first of all, I call this the borrowed trust syndrome, because we all don't want to spend our money till we see what someone else says. Now, the problem with those reviews is they're buried. People aren't always seeing them. They may be buried on your website. They may be buried on your social media. They may be buried in Google. That means people have to actively be looking for you to see them, which doesn't help you with your overall branding. And the problem with this ad, which drove me crazy, is this statement on the right side, which every time I see that in an advertisement, it gets me very angry because I'm looking out for the business, not the industry. See, this statement, enhance your floor with the, that's promoting the entire wood flooring industry. Everybody who sells flooring should chip in for this ad now, right? Hey, yeah, that's great. I'll go find a good flooring place. Saw a big realtor here in Tampa. Now's the time to sell your home. Thanks for the advice. I'll find a realtor. Get one of those reviews. And again, if I may use that term, externalize it. Get a good one. Don't mention the last name of the person. I mean, be kind to them, but stick it out there. Anything on the internet's fair game. You're allowed to exploit it. So stick it out there. Put it in your ads. Realtors, he sold it quick and above ask, right? That's how you get a listing, by reminding people, not only are you the name I trust, but you're going to do the job. Connect the dots. Now, I already said there's two ways to brand yourself. Testimonials is one. The second way is what I do a lot of. I try to look like an expert. I try to look smart. I put out a lot of newsletters. I put out a lot of information and advice because I'm not the cheapest, but I might be the smartest. And in tough economic times, you should constantly be reinforcing to your customer base the value you give them. Like my accountant now is hitting us once a week with COVID-19 information. He's doing that because he's not cheap. And as people are, you know, looking at their expenditures, would I drop my accountant? Well, he's reminding me that he's looking out for me. So is this merger and acquisition guy with his emails every week. So is my lawyer. Is this a goal you have? The answer is yes. In this study of over 3,500 small businesses, the number one reason you want to spend money on media is to get a new customer. But if you look at 2, 3, and 4, it's to maintain that customer, build your brand, and educate. So join the club. Don't just think about media as a one hit to try to instantly get someone to come into your business. Think of it as an ongoing investment in order to maintain yourself through tough economic times. Now, how much should you invest? Well, that's an interesting, I mean, no one would suggest that you should do more than you should. And pundits have different numbers now. Try to figure out what a small business should invest in marketing. And it depends mostly on gross sales. My number is 6. I religiously invest 6% of gross sales in advertising and marketing. Since our expenditures on conferences, which are very expensive to send people in booths and all that stuff, we're reshifting that money now into other forms of marketing. In general, I live by the 10% rule because we engage with thousands and thousands of small businesses through our media partner. But keep in mind that established businesses can spend less than new businesses. If you already have top of mind awareness, it's almost like getting that engine to start moving. Once it's moving and it has momentum, it requires less fuel. The airplane that's at 35,000 feet isn't blowing as much fuel as climbing up to 35,000 feet. So if you're an established business like a realtor who's already been around for a while, the average in the United States is 15% of gross sales. Newbies, 30%, a third of every dollar just to establish that critical TOMA. Automotive industry is so competitive now, it's almost 20%. And a lot of that money is moving to auto aftermarket, which means the fixing the car. You may likely know this or not, but there's more money in the service bay than the showroom, and used inventory is on fire now, which requires a lot of marketing dollars to get that used inventory out to show people what you have on the lot. Retail is a bit less, 8%, a little bit shy of the norm. Home improvement's a bit less. Medical's getting close at 7%, financial services at 6, education at 9. That is percentage of gross sales. So you can throw everything into that bucket if you want to, not just the expenditure you might do at a newspaper, but also in maintaining your signage, business cards, letterhead, and anything else you're doing in order to market yourself. Well, anyway, so quickly, if I may just review where we're at. Media is a necessity of any form, especially in tough economic times. I urge you to consider marketing now more than ever. As Barton said, the people want to advertise in good times, they have to in bad. Do it with the proper reach. Don't waste media. Don't throw it against a wall and see what sticks. Make a commitment and do it ongoing. And then a messaging becomes a critical part of that. If you do deals, offers, and specials, then most of you should do them seasonally when they're most effective. So you can have seasonal messages that are more bribe-oriented and branding the rest of the year. You could also do it like Walmart and then commingle them both. Walmart still does a hefty investment in coupons, but also does a lot of branding as well. Walmart never stops marketing. It now owns the retail, I guess, of the world. It's the largest retailer on the planet, but it never stops. It knows it's vulnerable. And consider branding, please. Small businesses just don't do that. Branding is an essential part of your business. I'm going to bring Sue in for a second. Sue, it was an honor and pleasure to be working with you today. I hope you could hear me through this thing. We have got just a few comments and I tried to address them. Are you still there, Sue? Hello.
Yes, I am. And thank you, Mike, for that presentation, especially the information about, you know, reach and frequency and staying top of mind in this tough time. And I did want to convey to everyone on the seminar that all three organizations sponsoring this event, the Town Association, the Business Association, and the paper, we're here to help our local businesses any way we can. We want to put our best efforts into everything, and we have great resources with Jane and Chuck, and reach out to them. Feel free to reach out to me and to Rhonda Schilling, who is our marketing director, who's on this call as well. So we want to be able to help you and or at least put you in contact with people who can.
Can I brag on one of your products?
I love that.
I went to your Facebook page and I asked you, do you allow, because many of my, I urge my newspaper clients to allow advertisers to commingle into our social media, right? Because it's, why not? It's local business, right? And it's fun content. And I was, you know, with this huge audience you have, but then I went back a couple of days, you had an ad, not an ad, but a mention for a business. I hope I did include this here. No, I didn't. Oh, is it the here it is. I'm sorry, I have the wrong logo. You had this events and catering place go into your social media feed. 27 people liked it. But what I loved was the comments I saw there where one of the readers actually complimented the business. Talk about a great review. Do you realize how powerful that is for a business? I just wanted to compliment you. It gives the business a little wonderful marketing. So congratulations. Good job.
Thank you.
Oh, so anyway, I promised a free book. If you would like a free book, and I don't know why that still says Denton, I'm sure, Sue, I had put your logo there. Please forgive me. This was the one I did yesterday afternoon at 5:00. Ignore that. Sue, are you going to forgive me for that? I'm sorry.
Of course.
That was a newspaper in Denton, Texas. This is this survey. If you go to blinder.biz/Daniel, don't go to Denton. That's Daniel, because I believe your island is spelled Daniel. You'll get to a form. If you go in there and you fill it out, the first thing I'm going to ask you is, what do you think of our broadcast? I'd be honored if you'd let me know, because this is a new product. We're going to be doing tons of these. And if I did a good job, my name is Mike Blinder. And if I did a bad job, my name is Susan Dieter. How's that, Susan? Tell me what you thought of the broadcast today. But after that, there will be messages to Sue. I'll send you the book. You don't have to fill these out. But if you'd like to just tell us, what's your target market, your reach? Do you have any deals, offers, and specials you're thinking of doing? And then more importantly, what's your unique selling proposition? What makes you different than the other guys? And then if you have anything you want to upload, I mean, a lot of you have pitch sheets or descriptions of your product or service, by all means, upload it. So some homework can be done before any media consultation takes place. The web address is blinder.biz. That's my last name, /Daniel. If you go there, fill out the form, I'll kick you back a copy of the book within 24 hours. Survival Selling. It is a B2B sales guide, but a lot of people say that's just a good read. I love it. I put a laser love when I wrote it. Sue, I want to thank you for your valuable time and thank your audience. And again, who was the wonderful people at the chamber? We should thank them too.
Yes, that would be the Daniel Island Business Association, Chuck Latif, and the Daniel Island Town Association, Jane Baker. They're here to help you. We're here to help you. Please reach out.
All right, everybody have a wonderful day. I wish you obviously success in anything you're doing with your business. And more importantly, I wish you and your family the best health we can in this society. Have a good day. Thank you.
Thanks, Mike.
And I won't ask again.
stay.